Thank you very much.
I would like to thank the organizing committee for their invitation, and thank you, Dr. Abdallah, for the introduction. I have a plane to catch, so I will wrap up my two presentations in just a few minutes, so apologize for this. First presentation, the toric IOL for management of astigmatism during the cataract surgery. As you know, that there is some paradigm shift during cataract surgery. In the modern cataract surgery, is not the aim now of the cataract surgery is not to correct the cataract or remove the cataract and correct the spherical arrow, but we have also to correct the cylinder for maximum visual potential and spectacle independence after the cataract surgery. So we have to address the second order abrasion, the defocus, as well as the cylinder or the astigmatism for the patient's eye. Why astigmatism? Astigmatism is a visually disabling refractive error, and 41% of the cataract patients have astigmatism of more than 0.75 diopters, and current trends now is to address the spectacle independence for the patients. There are a couple of these are a couple of lenses that I have experienced most, but you have a lot of toric lenses now available in the market, but I don't go will not go to into detailed specs of these lenses, and I'm sure you are pretty familiar or acquainted with these lenses or whatever the toric lenses in your hands, but my objective of this presentation is to how to optimize your results with the toric IOLs. First of all, there are five factors. First of all, we have the calculated personal surgical induced astigmatism, and the second factor is to accurate preoperative measurements, and the third is consider posterior corneal astigmatism, force accurate markings, and finally you have surgical technique counts for your results. First of all, you have to calculate your surgical induced astigmatism. It depends on mainly on the main wound incision, as well as the site size and construction of the way you construct the main wound of your cataract surgery. And calculation can be done by vector analysis, is not by algebraic summation between the K values or preoperative and postoperative values, but you have to do some vector analysis. It's pretty well complicated, but you can get on some online calculator for surgical induced astigmatism, and the most popular is the drhill.com, which is online calculator for free. You can just log on, register, and make an account for yourself, and then put some about 20 cases of cataract cases, preoperative K and postoperative K after 2 months, and then the software will calculate the surgical induced astigmatism for you. And there is as well an iPhone app which is available in the App Store for the iPhone. It's called Astigmatic Master, and you can see this is the app here. You can log on. You have a preoperative astigmatism and steep meridian, and the K value and the average K value, and the postoperative astigmatism, the steep meridian and the average K value, and then press calculate, and this software will calculate the surgical induced astigmatism for yourself. It's in my hand, it's 0.2 diopter of cylinder. The second factor to optimize your refractive results with the toric IOL is to have accurate preoperative measurements. That include the optical biometer, spherical for spherical power of the IOL, as well as to measure the astigmatism. And personally, I count on Placidus topographer more than the shine fluke images. And I count also as well as autokeratometer, IOL master, and all case of these devices, the three devices should at least agree with each other within 0.3 diopters of the amount of astigmatism and 5 degrees of the cylinder, of the axis of the cylinder. And the third factor is to consider posterior corneal astigmatism, because evaluating the astigmatic error is not just about the shape of the front surface of the cornea, but there is a fair amount of posterior corneal astigmatism on the back surface of the cornea that has its impact on the refractive results. It acts as a low power lens in the back surface of the cornea in the horizontal meridian. So you can just think about the posterior corneal astigmatism as it's against the rule astigmatism, hidden against the rule astigmatism that adds to your astigmatism of the patient. So for this example, if you had see the patient with against the rule astigmatism, you have to overcorrect this patient, and you, if the patient has against the rule with the rule astigmatism, you can undercorrect this cylinder of the patient or this corneal astigmatism, because there is a hidden posterior corneal astigmatism which generally against the rule. You can count on a Baylor nomogram, which is the with the rule astigmatism you can deduct 0.5 diopters, or against the rule astigmatism you had add to calculations 0.3 diopters, oblique astigmatism, you can deduct 0.2 or 0.1 astigmatism, but it's not very accurate, but it's at least much closer to emmetropia than if you did not, if you don't consider a posterior corneal astigmatism in your measurements. Luckily enough, now we have online calculator that, including the posterior corneal astigmatism, now it's an Acrisoft toric calculator, now it's available with a Barrett toric calculator now, which includes the posterior corneal astigmatism in your calculation. And this is another example for the Technis AMO, which you have the option to include or exclude the posterior corneal astigmatism in your calculation. I personally advise you to include the posterior corneal astigmatism in your calculation. You can see in this, for example, you can just check this mark here. Now this will include the posterior corneal astigmatism, otherwise you will not include it. For example, you can see this is a pretty interesting case. You can see this is a calculation of astigmatism for the patient for the toric IOL without inclusion the posterior corneal astigmatism, and you can see that the type of the lens is Technis 225, the model of the lens. And if we include the posterior corneal astigmatism here, you can see that the amount of astigmatism now changed, and the model of the lens now has been changed to Technis 300 with larger amount of cylindrical correction. So I advise to include the posterior corneal astigmatism in your calculation. The fourth factor is the cyclotorsion. And as you heard previously in the previous presentation, it's about cyclotorsion maybe about 2 to 4 degrees sometimes because of the changing position from the supine to seated position or vice versa. And cyclotorsion in some eyes can be large enough to reach 10 degrees of cyclotorsion, and the 10 degrees of misalignment with the toric lenses will result in 33% loss of astigmatic error, and 30 degrees of misalignment will result in induction of astigmatism for these patients. So we have to do some reference marking preoperatively in the 180 degrees, and there are several tools you can count on to mark the patients at the horizontal meridian while seated before being in the supine position in the OR. I prefer the digital markers of ASICO. You can see here that you can just mark the reference mark, or we can mark the axis for implantation of the toric lenses. As you can see in the movie here, it's very comfortable to the patient, and it's not bothering either for the doctor or the patient anyhow. And this is pretty accurate in my hands. Or you can use the Varian image guided system, which take a high resolution image for the eye in the seated position before going to the OR, and take the data from the iris pattern as well as limbal blood vessels and scleral blood vessels, and this data will correct the cyclotorsion while the patient in the OR during the surgery, and will just mark the axis for implantation of the IOL during the surgery for the surgeon. You don't need now markers in these cases. Surgical technique, of course, you have to be a little bit meticulous. If you are doing manual phaco emulsification, you have to keep at least your capsular axis within 5.5 millimeter in diameter, and you have to keep the axis as central as possible. And definitely, if you don't use the Varian digital markers or whatever the fancy instruments in the OR, you can just count on the regular instruments for marking the axis for implantation of the IOL. And I use the ASICO dual markers here, manual marker. And just if you did your job, if you calculate your surgical induced astigmatism, if you do the reference mark preoperatively accurately, and you can implant the lens now in the bag before final adjustment of the lens implantation, you have to keep the IOL off axis for about 10 to 15 degrees until you clear the OVD, wash out the OVD from the anterior chamber and from the capsular bag. And I advise you to use the cohesive viscoelastic, not the dispersive viscoelastic, and you have to wash the cohesive viscoelastic from underneath the IOL before placing the IOL in the correct position, otherwise it will rotate in the early post-operative period. And of course, femtosecond laser technology will have its role here, because you can count on the capsule rexes. Not only the size of the rexes will be much more accurate, but the location of the rexes, you can just locate the rexes within the center of the pupil, or sometimes if you have the catalyst machine, for example, you can center the rexes within the center of the geometric center of the lens capsule. Let me share with you some of the, my results. You can see this is the patient with the preoperative corneal astigmatism of 2 diopters. And you can see that the patient after implantation, you can see this is the astigmatism of the IOL after implantation. This is the corneal astigmatism, and the refractive astigmatism is reduced to 0.5 diopters. And this is another patient here. You can see this is a 2/4 of corneal astigmatism, and after implantation, this is the internal astigmatism by OPD aberrometer. By the toric IOL, this is opposite to compensate for the corneal astigmatism, and now the astigmatism, corneal astigmatism, has been reduced to a refractive astigmatism of 1/4 of a diopter. And this is another case for correction of astigmatism, results in 0 cylinder after implantation. So if you include the posterior corneal astigmatism, if you do your job with regards to the manual, the surgical technique, and you will have a pretty good, accurate results. Let me skip this one. This is the my results published, presented in ECRS a couple of years ago, and this is the comparison between the technistoric and the technospherical lens. We have significant reduction of the refractive cylinder, and this is the visual quality after implantation, because implantation, I believe that the implantation with the toric lens is way better than correction of astigmatism with on the corneal surface, because you don't induce higher order abrasions, rather than you can correct some spherical abrasion with the aspheric surface of the IOL. And you can see that point spread function is pretty tight, and the contrast sensitivity of this patient after implantation of the toric lens is much high. This is another patient in comparison as a control with the non-toric lens. This is a spherical lens implantation. You can see that point spread function is not as tight, of course, as the previous case, this one, and you can see that the contrast sensitivity of this patient is much more compromised compared to the other patient who corrected with the toric IOL. And you can see this is the contrast sensitivity. These lenses does not rotate in the early post-operative period because it's hydrophobic lenses now, so just when you implant the lens, leave the lens, usually it does not rotate too much. The average implantation in my average rotation rotation in my hands is 2.6 degrees within 2 months after the surgery. It's pretty stable within the capsular bag because it's hydrophobic lenses, and if you use the cohesive viscoelastic and you care enough to wash the viscoelastic before concluding the surgery from underneath the IOL, definitely you will have your IOLs within the bag in the position as you left it during the surgery. So my take-home message is emmetropia after cataract surgery is much closer than before. Meticulous preoperative measurements, technique, consideration are essential. Knowledge of the posterior corneal curvature will gain more importance in the near future. Soon we'll have machines that calculate properly the posterior corneal astigmatism, and intraoperative aberrometry probably are gaining much more popularity and will be the key player for accurate refractive results after cataract surgery. Thank you for your result. And let me go quickly for my next presentation, because I'm sorry, I have to run fast.
It seems that everybody is stuck with the flight schedule that at the end of the day. So we'll make the sessions a little bit condensed.
So this is my second presentation, IOS scaffold for rupture of the posterior capsule during cataract surgery. And posterior capsular tear, as you know, is the most common complication during phaco emulsification, and can occur even in routine cataract surgery cases without any outward signs of risk. And good management is to avoid subsequent issues for the surgeon as well as for the patients. IOL scaffold concept has been introduced by Amar Agrawal in American Academy meeting in 2011. It was published in the Journal of Refractive Surgery after being rejected in the Journal of Cataract and Refractive Surgery. The principle is when you have rupture of the posterior capsule and you still have some nuclear fragments within the capsular bag, if you do some more manipulation within the capsular bag, the opening in the posterior capsule will enlarge and the nuclear fragment will fall down in the anterior vitreous on the posterior segment of the eye. So your aim is just try to avoid enlargement of this posterior opening in the capsule. You have to stop, you have to inject OVDs, stabilize everything, and try to retrieve the nuclear fragments inside the anterior chamber. Get it out of the capsular bag. Try to get it inside the anterior chamber. Insert a multi-piece lens to act as a scaffold in the anterior chamber to prevent nuclear fragments from falling down in the posterior segment of the eye. Continue your phaco emulsification and then place the IOL in the sulcus. And let me show you a couple of movies here. This is a case of brunescent cataract of a very old man. It's a dense cataract. I gave the patient guarded prognosis. We might convert to extracapsular cataract surgery, but for the last quadrant, everything went uneventful. In the last quadrant, as you can see, I suspected a small opening in the posterior capsule. You can see here, this is a small break in the posterior capsule. Luckily enough, I don't have any vitreous prolapse yet at that time. So what to do in this case is just stop. Don't pull out your phaco tip from the anterior chamber of the eye and before injection of OVDs, and preferable to be dispersive OVD inside the anterior chamber and the capsular bag. And then prepare the IOL, multi-piece IOL should be prepared. And implant the lens here. This is a sensor IOL. I don't have any financial interest, but you have to insist for a multi-piece IOL. Insert the IOL in the anterior chamber. It's not in the sulcus, just in the anterior chamber in the very beginning, just behind the nuclear fragment, after getting the nuclear fragment in the anterior chamber. And then continue your phaco emulsification, but be careful that you are doing anterior chamber phaco emulsification. So you have to reduce your ultrasound. Try as much as you can to reduce your fluidics inside the eye and do some slow motion phaco until you get rid of this nuclear fragments. You can continue irrigation aspiration if you are pretty sure you don't have vitreous prolapse inside the anterior chamber. And then after completion of the cortical cleanup, you can now place the haptics, each haptic at a time, in the sulcus of the eye. And it's preferred, of course, to do some optic capture within the capsular rexus. You can stay in the anterior chamber to make sure that you don't have any vitreous prolapse before concluding the surgery. Do your stromal hydration in the usual way, and then you'll find the case will be completed without any sequelae. Here it is. So this is another case with a larger break and almost half of the nucleus still to be emulsified. This is a routine case. The cataract was not as dense as the previous case, and for no reasons, I had a posterior capsule rupture. And you can see here is some sudden deepening of the anterior chamber. You can see here it is, sudden deepening of the anterior chamber. You don't have to deny too much. Try it, okay, no, there is a still break. I'm sure there is a break. Inject dispersive OVD. Try to get this heminucleus inside the anterior chamber. I'm a chopper surgeon. I'll try to do some chops, but definitely this lens heminucleus was not chopped properly. And then implant the multi-piece lens, the three-piece lens, inside the anterior chamber. And because I was not confident with the leading haptic, where the leading haptic is going, whether it is in the anterior chamber or in the sulcus or probably in the bag, so I prefer to keep the trailing haptic outside the eye, just in case the lens might fall down inside the posterior segment of the eye. Then continue your phaco emulsification in the usual way. Definitely you have to reduce your parameters, especially the ultrasound, because you are pretty close to the corneal endothelium at that stage of the surgery. Try to do some mechanical crushing of the nuclear fragments to aid the ultrasound or to reduce the ultrasound before completion. Then I found that the leading haptic was already in the sulcus, so I have to remove it and put the lens inside the anterior chamber. Do dry vitrectomy, do whatever you want, do your technique to complete the surgery, to clean the vitreous, to clean the cortex, and then you have to implant the lens again within the sulcus of the eye, each haptic at a time, using a Sinisky hook, and do your optic capture. And definitely, if you have intact rexus, it's preferable to do the optic capture because it adds the stability to of the lens in the early post-operative period. And this is another case. You can see here, this is a large, very large break, and fragments inside, falling already inside in the anterior vitreous of the eye. So try to, as much as you can, get the cortex and the nucleus and epinucleus inside the anterior chamber. Do ample amount, inject ample amount of dispersive OVD to protect your corneal endothelium and to inflate the anterior chamber, inflate the capsular bag, and tamponade the vitreous in the posterior direction. Implant the three-piece lens in the anterior chamber. Do the irrigation, do the phacoemulsification in the usual way here. And of course, definitely you have to do some vitrectomy. Start with the high cut, low vacuum, irrigation cut aspiration in the very beginning. And then you can change your strategy. Again, low cut, high vacuum, irrigation aspiration cut to try to retrieve some of the fragments that has been wandering in the anterior vitreous of the eye. And I could get this fragment, this is small epinucleus piece, just by injection of OVD with the cannula, and then get it above the IOL optic, and then you can just get it with the phaco handpiece or whatever. You can do some mechanical crushing with the bimanual irrigation aspiration or with the vitreous cutter, and do the irrigation aspiration afterwards. And this is still vitrectomy. We are doing anterior vitrectomy, high vacuum, irrigation aspiration cut to try to clear the vitreous as well as the cortex from the capsular bag and from the anterior vitreous. And then, after cleaning of the cortex, you can now place the IOL within the sulcus and in the usually as mentioned before, and then do the optic capture. Here you can see the optic capture. Once you have a successful optic capture, you will find your rexus is not regular anymore, but rather than oblong, because it had been stretched by the haptic optic junction in either direction. And this is the first post-operative day after implantation of the of the IOL in the sulcus of optic capture. You can see this is small, non-significant cortical fragments. I could notice that this is the complicated case that I did yesterday by this small non-significant cortex behind the IRL, and it was not has any visual significant issues. So the tips here is to try to don't panic when you have the such complication. Use the multi-piece IOL is a must. Never use the single piece in the sulcus. Ample amount of dispersive OVD. And definitely I use the viscote in such cases. I don't have any financial interest. Clear the pathway for the IOL by limited anterior vitrectomy and by the vitrector in the anterior chamber before implanting the IOL in the anterior chamber. Strive to keep your rexus intact, because this rexus will hold the lens in the sulcus and will hold the optic of the lens when you do the optic capture. And definitely optic capture ensure excellent long-term centration and avoid troubles after the surgery. Thank you for your attention. And this is concluded my presentation and participation for this symposium. Thank you very much.
First of all, I want to compliment the organizers for such a wonderful conference, and I'm very honored to be a guest. I guess this is a session for the diehards who are here at the last session. I will talk about the difference between the bifocal and the trifocal IOLs. These are my financial disclosures. Now, I'll start with the bifocal IOLs. They correct aphakia, and we know that they correct the distance vision, and they can correct for one distance at near, which can be between 1.5 and 4 diopters in the lens plane. The mechanism of action can be different. It can be diffractive or diffractive apodized. It can be refractive. We have hybrid refractive diffractive lenses, and we have radially asymmetric IOLs. And it's important to know how they work so that you can prepare your patients to be prepared for what they might see. The trifocal IOLs correct aphakia as well, and they correct the distance vision just as regular IOLs do. But they correct the near at two distances. One is near and one is intermediate. The mechanism of actions can be a difference between different lenses, either by the use of secondary harmonic aberrations like the fine vision lens does, or by diffractive apodization like the Zeiss lens does, or without diffraction, without apodization like Alcon the Panoptics does. And there is a refractive trifocal IOL on the market, the mini well. I haven't met anyone who's used this yet. In any case, when we compare these lenses, what you can see is that they have a diffractive zone that's different. The Panoptics has the smallest diffractive zone, while in the Acrylis and in the fine vision, they go all the way to the edge of the optic. They are either diffractive and non-apodized or apodized, and using different things. So the Panoptics has a pattern that will reduce halos mostly, and the fine vision is using secondary harmonic aberrations. When looking at the modulation transfer function at the different pupil openings, you can see that all three lenses, in red it's the Panoptics, the purple one is the Zeiss lens, and the green one is the fine vision lens. We can see that they both correct distance and near vision quite well. As usual, the distance is dominant. It has to be, because otherwise at night people wouldn't be able to function at all. And then the intermediate, that's the big question. How is it functioning? And basically, the earlier versions of the trifocal IOLs don't function as well as the newer one. So here we have the Zeiss and the fine vision giving an intermediate vision, but we see that the MTF for the Panoptics is much better. Light distribution in lenses that are multifocal or bifocal or trifocal is always decreased because some of the light is being dispersed. Some of the light is going to the far, some of the light is going to the near, and some of the light is diffracted away in outer space, I guess. Now, the first generation of trifocals has a maximal light retention of 84 to 86%, and the currently newer lenses, the trifocal lenses of Alcon, have a light retention of 88%. So every time a new lens comes out, somehow the optical physicists are able to make such a pattern on the optic that we will retain more light and have less side effects. Now, these are two articles, one by Gatinel and one by Carson, showing us the modulation transfer function of different lenses. So here in red you can see the fine vision. The fine vision has a distance focus, an intermediate, and I can't see it here, but they have a near focus here. You can see that the modulation transfer mode of a bifocal IOL is very good. Now, in the other graph, you can see basically three trifocal IOLs. And interestingly, there's only one IOL that really has a peak at the intermediate. All the others, it looks more than noise to me, but who am I? In any case, how does this work? When we have a bifocal IOL, we have a diffractive apodized surface. So we have those rings that are displaced at different distances and different heights to make sure that we get two separate foci. When you're using harmonic aberrations, you basically have two sets of rings. One set of ring is for the distance and the near vision, and the second set of rings diffracts the light to the intermediate and to the far away. What was done with the quadrifocal or trifocal IOL, they took one of the foci that was going to add to the distance and were left with two foci for near and intermediate. And now this intermediate is the biggest thing that everyone is discussing. So here you can see the secondary harmonic aberrations of the fine vision, and here you can see the trifocal IOL and the Panoptics, in which you can see that the gratings are made such that it's smoothened out so that you have a refraction for the distance of the fourth focus. So here in the graph you get four foci. The one at 120 centimeters is diffracted away for the distance, and we get two equally strong intermediate at 60 and a near one at 40 centimeters. And this is how the lens looks in the eye. We should not forget that it doesn't matter whatever pattern those lenses have on the surface, they all cause side effects. So here you can see the side effects of glare caused by monofocal IOLs, And here we can see of the 2.5 diopter Alcon lens, the Restore. Here we can see the Technis bifocal IOL. Here we can see, I need to look at the screen, the Acrylisa bifocal, and this is the trifocal. So we can see, and it's logical, for every focus that we induce more side effects. These are Badal pictures of different multifocal IOLs. So here you have the 2.5 diopter addition of Alcon. So yes, it works a little bit at the intermediate, it works well at the distance. It's so-so for the near. Then here you have the Technis again, near and distance is the best. Acrylisa, we can see again that near and distance is the best. And the trifocal, we see that there is some intermediate, but it's not really up to par when comparing to the distance pictures. This is another way of showing it with an ETDRS chart. And again, we see that all those lenses, the Acrylisa, the trifocal, the panoptics, and the fine vision, they correct the distance rather well. Now, this is not a really very honest slide, because if you want to do the intermediate, you should really pick the place where the focus of the intermediate is lying. So in this case, at 60 centimeters, the only lens that's performing well, it's panoptics, because that's where their intermediate is. The other lenses will not give you any sharpness of vision there. And also at 80 centimeters, none of these three lenses give this. This should have been done at the intermediate distances of both other lenses. In terms of glare, this is a picture that's trying to show us what the glare is that different lenses give. So we can see that the bifocal IOL basically gives much less glare than any of the trifocal IOLs. And the Acrylisa, we know people see this more because of the material that was used and the lathing of the surface of the lens. Now, looking at the literature, it's a little bit difficult to distill the data because there is a paucity of data. We don't have a lot of literature out there. There are actually no randomized clinical trials yet. And the last lens was launched just a year and a half ago. And I had the honor of doing the first panoptic toric 10 days ago or 8 days ago, last Friday. So the comparison is very difficult between all those different lenses, because what should we compare, uncorrected near and distance, or should we just look at the refraction? And there's no consensus on how we are looking at the near vision. Should we check it monocularly? Should we check it binocularly? We have no standardization of patient satisfaction, and quality of vision is really a big, big discussion. Many people are using a machine that's called the OCAS, and then from my teacher, I will tell you it's not validated, so why are you using it? And I'm using something else. We have no consensus on how to measure higher order aberrations, and I'm not even sure how relevant these are, because we're correcting lower order aberrations. Now, as to near and intermediate, again, we have no consensus on monocular or binocular reading. Should we use a chart? Should we use a reading desk? This is also money given, because any test that you do that takes more time will cost you more money. It's very simple. One of the ways to do compare these lenses is to perform defocus curves. They also cost a little bit of time, but they're very effective. Now, as to why are intermediate distances so important to us? Well, we live we're screenagers, basically, right? We're on our mobile phones, we're on our PCs, and we do more or less everything within an arm's length distance of what we do. Now, the American Occupational Safety and Health Administration has found out that for most people of average height, like me, 60 centimeters is more than enough. Now, for example, the Dutch nation, they're the tallest in the world, and they have more people who are 2 meters tall or taller. They would do better with an intermediate of 80 centimeters, but most of us in this hall would not do that. Then, so I was wondering which would be the best distance to use for the intermediate. I took a ruler and went around in my kitchen, as you can see. So for cooking, I don't need more than 60 centimeters. The dishwasher needs a little bit more, so that's why I have children, they do that. And taking things out of the fridge is no problem at all. And when I want to read the newspaper, well, big newspapers don't exist anymore, nearly, so the tablet is fine with 50 to 60 centimeters, and so is my computer distance. In this slide, you can see the trifocal acrylisa study of Thomas Conan, and he shows here the defocus curve of the acrylisa trifocal. Interestingly, the far vision, the distance vision, is very, very good. This is in logMAR, so these people have a mean of better than 20/20 vision, and the nearby is okay, but it's not 20/20. And there is a dip in the intermediate, which comes to a 0.8 decimal at about minus one. So this is the intermediate that this gives. Now this is from the same author, Thomas Conan, the first six eyes with the panoptics. And this is spectacular, basically. Because if you look between a plus 1/2 diopter and minus three, all these patients are better than 20/20, seeing better than 20/20. This is distance corrected, I must say. So this is really a very good outcome. Now what I did is I took all the defocus curves I could find in the literature, and I went and I plotted all those plots, and I made a compound graph of these. So in red you can see the panoptics. And yes, it has a visual acuity better than 20/20 for far away, and very good, also better than 20/20 for the near vision. And intermediate is okay, but with, including my cases, I'm not above 20/20 at the intermediate distance. It's still very, very good. It's very near to the 20/20, to the logMAR zero, but it's a little bit underneath. Interestingly, the acrylisa is performing very well, the green one, at the intermediate, but it drops off at near. The near vision isn't as nearly as good as the panoptics. And this is also what the fine vision does. So I think that these kind of graphs can give you a better idea of how these things perform, but of course you have to trust the person giving you the data. Then, these are older defocus curves.
Doctora.
I'll run up. And what you can see in these is that the 20/20 is reached, and the intermediate isn't so bad either, it's 0.63. Because I need to speed up, I'll skip a couple of slides. These are the bifocal defocus curves, this is the panoptics defocus curve. But now I want to show you the difference for the intermediate, whether it's a 0.8 decimal or 0.63. The difference isn't at all so big, but the difference can be very big in terms of quality of vision. I skipped to stray light. Stray light for us is a measure of quality of vision, and what we can show is that stray light, this is a pseudo-phakic norm for stray light, so we can show that this is the norm for monofocal lenses in people who had monofocal lenses implanted during cataract surgery. And all these dots are from the literature, all the data that all kinds of people showed where stray light is with multifocal IOLs. And when I plot my own data, so you can see here, this is the Restore, the bifocal IOL. It really has high quality of vision because the stray light is low. Not all the light is being strayed. And we can see here that with the panoptics and the Zeiss lenses, it's a little bit higher, as to be expected, because we have an extra focus, okay? So, the decision you have to make with your patient is to look at the light distribution. You have to look at how many halos people would be able to accept, the high level of freedom of spectacles that people expect to have, and the patients need to do introspection. We don't have a test for neuroadaptation. People really need to look at their own behavior and make a decision. It's also a shared decision. You give them some of the responsibility for their decision, and I think that's very important. And they needed to make a decision with which they're at peace. You need a balance. So shared decision making is important. Availability of IOLs. For example, the panoptics has not yet been launched in the States, I think, and the acrylisa trifocals don't have an FDA approval. The price of the IOLs is very important. Some of the IOLs are extremely expensive and some are not, and someone has to pay the price for this. So it's your choice between a very, very good car and an excellent, excellent car, I guess. The trifocal IOL is given more natural defocus curve. Contrast sensitivity and light loss issues are being solved. They won't be completely solved because it's like Dojasin said beforehand, we live with the lenses that we were given and they work the best. And the question is, do you need a better natural defocus curve or a natural-like defocus curve with a little bit more loss of contrast, or can you adapt your behavior to a bifocal IOL which will keep some more of the contrast sensitivity in your own eye, in your own pocket? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
My assignment today is to talk about fixing the unhappy multifocal intraocular lens patient. I can assure you I have no financial advantage in creating unhappy multifocal IOL patients. Ideally, multifocal intraocular lenses provide full refractive correction at all distances with excellent visual acuity. My world is different. I have a consultative practice, and I frequently see these patients with difficulties. Some years ago, we published a retrospective review of 62 consecutive eyes from unhappy patients with multifocal IOLs. I believe it took about 2.5 years to accumulate these. So we published 43 eyes of 32 patients with adequate follow-up for analysis. Their complaints included blurred vision, photic phenomena, and both. The eventual etiologies are shown in this chart: ametropia, tear deficiency, posterior capsule opacity, some unexplained lens decentration, retained lens fragments. Management included glasses, refractive surgery, dry pre-treatment, YAG, midriatics, argon iridoplasty, some multifactorial, some we couldn't improve, and we had to remove 7% or 3 of them. What do we learn from this experience and our ongoing experience with these patients? Well, we learned to create a management algorithm. First, to look for residual refractive error. These lenses are very sensitive to minimal refractive error. They create an imperfect optical system even under the best of circumstances. And if you add refractive error on top of that, then you're likely to have an unhappy patient. So refract and determine whether the symptoms are relieved or not. My technicians typically refract the patients. I take a chart and take a look and I see the refraction. And then I have to go to talk to the technician. I say, no, not only do I want the visual acuity, but I want you to clearly record whether they are happy with their visual quality with that refraction or not. If they're happy, you can offer corneal refractive surgery to achieve freedom from spectacle wear. This is the low-hanging fruit. Next, look for surgical complications and pre-existing conditions if refraction won't help. These include, most commonly, keratoconjunctivitis sicca with an irregular ocular surface, topographic abnormalities, Formfrieze keratoconus, pseudophakic corneal edema, Fuchs dystrophy, and posterior segment abnormalities, CME, epiretinal membranes, diabetic retinopathy. Take a look at the centration of the intraocular lens implant. Make sure that the pupil selects the appropriate part of the implant to give them the benefit of the multifocal optics. If it doesn't and the decentration is small, you can consider argon laser pupil opacity, 5 microns, 5 milliwatts, to change the pupil size. Sometimes this is temporary, but it may be worth doing more than once. Surgical repositioning or exchange may be required. Pupil size issues can also play a role. Dilating agents or constricting agents may be the solution. You can give them a try. Posterior capsule opacities is in the list. But be certain this is the problem, because intraocular lens exchange is more difficult with the capsule open, YAG if necessary. Frequently, I see these patients having been referred, and on the way out the door, they get a YAG. It's unfortunate if they have to have the lens removed. No findings on exam. If there is acceptable distance visual acuity, we give them reading glasses and tell them they just didn't get the effect that they wanted from the multifocal optics. If it's unacceptable, then we're led to intraocular lens exchange. We've done everything we can to find a problem that's fixable, and we can't, so we remove the lens. Let's take a look at a couple of cases. Number one is a 65-year-old male who could not read or see distant objects clearly after implantation of his multifocal. Visual acuity is without correction, 2100 and J10. The implant was well centered, the posterior capsule was clear, the fundus exam was normal, the potential acuity meter read 20/20, and his OCT was normal. What did I leave out? He had Fuchs dystrophy. The corneal thickness was only 590. However, the presence of the guttae scattered enough light and distorted his vision enough to create symptoms. So we decided to remove the intraocular lens implant. There are several ways that this can be done, but if you're able to do it, this is a very simple and elegant way. You simply fold the lens inside the eye, remove it through the same incision through which it was implanted, and implant a new lens. 2 weeks after the exchange with a monofocal implant, this patient's acuity was 20/40 without correction, with a slight manifest refraction, 20/20. He eventually underwent LASIK to achieve good distance vision without correction. He wore reading glasses for near. This patient had poor visual quality due to Fuchs dystrophy and the multifocal optics. Case two is a 55-year-old white female unable to see well enough to drive after implantation of a multifocal. 2100 and J5 were her visions. The problem here is relatively obvious. After checking the endothelial cell count, we decided to recenter her implant and fixate it. So this was a surgical procedure. I insert a hypodermic needle, which is cut for stabilization, bringing the lens forward enough to indent the iris so that I know where to put fixation sutures. Put fixation sutures, tie them, remove the supporting lens, and reposit the iris with good centration. The third case is a 70-year-old man who underwent implantation of a crystal lens in one eye, restore in the left. Had good distance vision and near vision, was poor in the right eye. Good distance vision, poor vision at near in the right eye. Vision in the left eye, poor at all distances. Crystal lens typically produces very poor near vision. I don't implant them anymore. Slit lamp exam showed an open posterior capsule, but the anterior capsule overlying the optic of the restore was interfering with light transitioning through the outer rings. He underwent a YAG to open the anterior capsule. His manifest for LASIK, which we planned to perform to fix his refractive error, was this. With that refraction, his near vision was J16. What was the problem? The technician refracted the near portion of the implant. Always check the near vision before performing refractive surgery on multifocal implant patients. Here's a repeat manifest refraction, 20/20 distance visual acuity and J2 of the happy patient. He underwent LASIK and did well. So here's the management algorithm, which illustrates essentially what I just told you. In summary, multifocal implant optics are imperfect and do not function well in patients with any other abnormalities of the visual system, uncompromising personalities, or insufficient motivation to avoid glasses. Patient selection is very important. We recommend a methodical approach to identify the problem when they come in with complaints. Do everything possible to avoid intraocular surgery. Perform it only if necessary. And don't perform a capsulotomy until you are sure that the lens will not have to be removed. Thank you.
Thank you very much.